Hi, I'm Nancy O'Neill. What does aging gracefully mean to you? Well, it means something different to everyone. No matter what age you may be, Aging Gracefully on Suncoast FYI offers advice that could help you live a healthier life. Each week, we hear from a variety of specialists on a wide range of subjects. So please join us for Aging Gracefully on Suncoast FYI. Our conversation on liposuction with Dr. Sessa continues today with abdominoplasty, or a tummy tuck. Hello, doctor. Welcome back.
Hi.
Okay,
thanks.
So to continue our discussion where we left off on liposuction, what is the next stage if someone has to have skin removed?
Yeah. So an abdominoplasty person or patient, or AKA tummy tuck, if you notice you have loose skin, mainly between your belly button down to your pubic bone, there's lots of fat there, lots of loose skin. A lot of times women, after they've had, you know, one child or a couple of children, or just as we age, we tend to gather some sort of loose skin, and it bothers people because when you sit down, it bunches up.
Sure.
So the main procedure to take care of that and to give you back a more youthful appearance to your stomach is an abdominoplasty. So what's involved with this surgery is essentially you get an incision from hip to hip, but it's in a well-hidden area, right in your bikini line.
Okay.
We sort of raise up, remove the fat, remove the skin, and in such a way pull it down. So we remove, you know, almost all of the skin and muscle, skin and fat from your pubic area all the way to your belly button.
Okay.
And then so everything from there comes all the way down to the bottom, and that's why your belly gets tight. So we take out like 20 to 30% of your tummy.
Wow. Now, when you say, you know, is this in conjunction with liposuction, or it's
can be? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's various types of abdominoplasties that can be done. There's mini tummy tucks. There's full abdominoplasties. There's maxi tummy tucks. One tummy tuck that I like to do is an Avalar tummy tuck, which is so named from this Brazilian surgeon from many years ago. But it's a liposuction tummy tuck. So what I do is I liposuction all of the fat all around the whole tummy, the hips, the flanks, as well as on your whole tummy area. And then all of that loose skin that's been created now because it's empty, I remove that skin. And it's the same exact incision line from a standard abdominoplasty.
Really?
But with this type of procedure, you get a flat belly, flat tummy, much better contours. With a standard traditional tummy tuck, you can't really do liposuction on the front part of your tummy, because it can leave problems to healing.
Okay, now once you've had this procedure, is this a permanent procedure? Does it come back? And second part of that is who's a good candidate for this type of surgery?
So, well, first of all, anyone is that has this issue when they look in the mirror or put clothes on is a good candidate for it. But as far as the permanence of it, it's as permanent as it gets. But if you had a tummy tuck and then you got pregnant and had a baby, it would pretty much destroy the result, because all that skin that was removed would just be stretched again.
Okay, so that's good to know. Somebody should wait until after their
children. That's right.
Okay. Is there a specific age that this works better for than others, doctor?
I've done tummy tucks on women from 25 to 75.
Okay.
So it really depends on you, whether or not you plan on having more children.
And
how aesthetically conscious you are about your body.
Okay. And so what are some of the other aspects somebody can receive from having this procedure done?
Really just better contour to your stomach, better contour to your sides. So I can give you more of that sort of hourglass appearance, mm-hmm. rather than if you put weight on your sides, you get more of that square appearance.
Okay.
Of course, if you have a protuberant belly,
yep.
a lot of times during these procedures, I could actually tighten the muscles, and which could flatten your tummy.
Mm-hmm.
If you feel like you're having issues with the way that you look, if you don't like the way you
sure.
look, you know, come in as you are and leave as you want.
I like it. I like it. And your website, I have to say, for our audience, that Dr. Sessa's website is fabulous. Anything that you want to revisit on this, he has a lot of informational videos on there. So please keep that in mind, as well as watching our segments on SNN TV. What is the downtime? Let's get back to this. What is the downtime for this procedure?
Generally about a week.
Okay.
For a full abdominoplasty with muscle, it's called plication, with muscle fixation, with or without some liposuction, is about a week downtime. If I do liposuction tummy tuck, there's a little bit less of a downtime,
mm-hmm.
because it's not quite the amount of surgery. It's a little bit less surgery. Even though I'm removing fat, I'm not doing as much surgery, so the recovery is quicker. Generally 4 days, but generally about a week is what you want to put aside for something like this.
And is this also performed in your facility?
Yeah. Okay. So all these procedures are performed on, you know, relatively healthy people.
Okay.
If they're not healthy, then number one, I would probably talk you out of having the procedure.
Mm-hmm.
But if you absolutely needed to have it, we
mm-hmm.
just go to the hospital and do it.
Okay, awesome. Well, thank you again.
Yeah.
Always nice to see you.
Thank you.
Please stay tuned. Aging Gracefully on Suncoast FYI will return after a short break.
We have a new guest in the studio, Dr. Jessica Lipham. She is here today to discuss how food can play a big role in aging gracefully. Welcome to the show, Doctor. Nice to see you.
Thank you, Nancy, for having me.
Now, food. Obviously, it plays a huge role in how we feel. How do we know what foods are helping us and what foods are hurting us?
Great question. So, there's a mystery out there that a lot of people don't know that I would like to share right now, and that is, you know when you have an allergy to a food because mm-hmm. it gives you a very abrupt reaction of sorts. For example, maybe your throat closes, so mm-hmm. you would know right away not to have that food again.
Mm-hmm.
There's another form that exists out there in an immunological response. So there's two main immunological responses that the body has when we eat food.
Yep.
One being an allergy, the second is the sensitivity. And there's actually a test out there that is very simple. It's a finger stick. Mm-hmm. And the way I explain it to my patients is that it's almost like we're skimming the pool of their blood and reading the antibody reactions to each one of the 96 foods. The test I run has 96 standard American diet type
that's
foods.
That's what I was going to say, things that mm-hmm. most people would eat
yes.
on a regular basis.
There is also a Chinese food panel and a Mexican American food panel that does have different varieties of foods.
Mm-hmm.
But usually I'll run the standard 96 food panel. And really what we're doing is we're trying to identify how foods affect you in the not so obvious way. So the sensitivity reacts in the body 12 to 72 hours after you eat the food.
So you don't know if
you
you've eaten
know.
Something right away what it was.
Right. And the second thing that's tough for people to identify what they're sensitive to is that it's not obvious like the allergy is.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
it happens up to 3 days later. So
mm-hmm.
honestly, most people don't know what they've had to eat 3 days ago.
Exactly.
So it's very difficult to keep track of. And I think this is the fast track way to identify which foods are causing problems.
Okay.
And the problems come in the way of inflammation.
Mm-hmm.
And because each person is a biodynamic individual,
mm-hmm.
the ways that that inflammation will manifest could be different for each person. For example, could be gut issues for one, skin issues for another,
mm-hmm.
mood issues, believe it or not,
mm-hmm.
for someone else. So there's lots of different ways the sensitivities present themselves.
Okay. Now, how long does the test actually take? I mean, you just
take a fingerprint?
Under 2 minutes.
Okay. And then?
And you don't do anything at all to prepare for it.
Okay.
And it's about 2 weeks to get the results. Mm-hmm. And what I love about the results also is that it's not just a yes or no, you do well with this food or you don't. You actually get a chance to see on a scale of 1 to 6 how reactive is your biochemistry to that food. And so you can really see which are the most inflammatory foods.
Okay, so that it will tell you, okay, these foods, well, maybe there are 1 to 2, some of them that you know that you should avoid because they're just off the charts for your particular body, and everybody is different.
Everybody is different. There's been a gluten-free craze, of course, everybody knows about it. And what I've seen interestingly clinically in the last couple years is that even though people are already choosing to eat gluten-free, when we run the sensitivity, we find out that it's actually the baker's yeast that they're sensitive to. And so they get clarity on what is okay for their bodies and what isn't.
Okay. So the inflammation that this can cause in your body obviously causes...
That's what hinders our aging.
There you go.
Yeah.
So if you can stay away from these things, and it's very interesting because I've had this done and I really enjoyed it. And it's really helped me, you know, the guidelines. And again, there's things that you're unaware of that you go like, oh my gosh, yogurt, love yogurt. Well, that may not be good for me, but it may be good for you.
Yeah, and even the most healthy foods, apples, garlic, onions, I've seen almost everything come up for different individuals, so.
So another question that I wanted to ask you. You suggest a foundational support through supplements also on a daily basis.
I do. There's a couple things that I suggest and I also take myself. And what I mean by foundational is the most of our immune system, and a lot of people don't know this either, is in our gut lining. So about 75 to 80% of our immune system is in what's called the gut-associated lymphoid tissue that's on the ground floor.
Okay.
So when I talk about ground floor or terrain with my patients, that's what I mean about the foundation. We want to make sure that we're keeping the gut lining cells very healthy so that we're allowed to absorb and utilize all the nutrients. And I usually will talk about probiotic being one of those because the gut lining itself has many different species of bacteria and we're really just scraping the surface right now as far as what each one of those bacteria actually does. They're finding they have different jobs. And one of the things kind of looping back to the food sensitivity test, of course, is that you want to find out if you're sensitive to dairy, because many of the probiotics on the market right now are dairy-derived.
Yes.
So when you identify a dairy sensitivity, even if you're taking a probiotic that has dairy in it, then it's not really going to end up being supportive. It's going to be more inflammatory for that foundation.
Yeah. And these are things that you really need to see some...
Well, and to have guidance.
To have guidance from
it's
you.
It's really...
Now, I know that there are some that you recommend. That krill is one?
Krill is another foundational supplement. And the reason being is...
Now, is that a probiotic?
Nope. It's an essential fatty acid. And most people have heard of fish oils.
Right. Okay.
The problem at this point, of course, is that the fish in the sea are sick.
Right.
And so we really don't want to have... large fish oil going in our bodies on a daily basis because of the processing. So I really recommend the krill for people.
And why? Why
the
is krill?
Is,
how is that different?
The krill is very different from fish oils. When you look at the biochemistry of the krill, it actually has a huge chunk of something that's called phospholipids.
Okay.
And so we could translate that into brain food.
Okay.
All right.
But the thing is, they only live for a very short period of time, so they're the purest form.
They really are. They're pure essential fatty acids. Essential fatty acids mean we have to ingest it from outside of ourselves. We don't make this on our own.
Right. Okay.
And it's, of course, back to the foundation, it's exactly what the cell lining needs to heal itself from inflammation.
So one final question.
Okay.
If you could tell us what the three most important foods for our bodies are, what would they be?
Well, number one, of course, is water, and some would not call that a food, but it is. You can live for many days without food, but you cannot live for many days without water. Okay. So water is a major player in our everyday, and we have all kinds of other lovely things to drink, but water is very important. to keep flushing inflammation out. Number two food would be the krill.
Okay.
Or cold every day.
Okay.
Cold water fish is okay, but the recommendation is not to have it more than two times a week.
Okay.
Because the sea is sick. And then number three is coconut oil, another brain food, natural antibiotic, something that you could literally just eat by the tablespoon.
Wow. And cook with it as well.
Absolutely. Right? And cook with it.
All right. Well, thank you. We learned a lot today, and I look forward to having you back very soon.
Thanks, Nancy.
Thanks.
Thank you for tuning in to Aging Gracefully on Suncoast FYI. We'll return right after the break.
Co-owner of Therapeutic Lifestyle Solutions and clinical director Toya Crutchfield returns to discuss what Therapeutic Lifestyle Solutions' approach is to osteoarthritis. Welcome back.
Thank you, Nancy.
Nice to see you. Nice to be here as always. So what is osteoarthritis, Toya?
Good old Arthur, right? None of us can escape it. Osteoarthritis is one of those things. It's kind of known as wear and tear arthritis. It's something that we get from life, from gravity, from life, from everything that we do.
So is it something that older people tend to get, or do you see it in younger people?
You definitely see it in younger people as well. You know, it so much depends on so many different factors as to when arthritis may actually surface its ugly head, but it is always going to sooner or later. Some people get it sooner than later. It's very different from like rheumatoid arthritis, which is a whole different set of circumstances. Osteo is one of those things, you know, we're always told to be very active in our lives, and most of us always try to be. Sometimes there's a payoff for that as well, because you know, we do a lot of things that are really high intense and can cause us to start having some joint issues, especially in our knees, our hips, as well as our backs. But hands, feet, you know, they're most all joints are susceptible to osteoarthritis.
So everybody is at risk.
Everyone's at risk.
What is the best approach to stay this off?
You know, it's kind of one of those situations where, although a lot of activity is one of the things that can be a culprit of osteoarthritis, it's basically where the cartilage that is between the joints that acts like a cushion, much like we were discussing with disc and everything else, when it starts breaking down and it allows the bones to start getting closer to each other, it creates, you know, a lot of swelling in the joint, a painful joint. So, you know, the best approach for that, especially depending on how severe the person has it and if they have it in multiple joints, we believe we have a wonderful pool program at our facility, and we believe that water-based therapy can be one of those things where you can do a lot of strengthening, you can do a lot of resistive training in the water, because you get resistance from all sides in the water.
Water versus land.
Water versus land. Land is kind of the thing that starts setting us up for it because of, you know, the gravity compression and the things that we do. So in the water, you know, especially in our pool, we have a heated pool. It's 96 degrees. It's salt water. We have both a deep and a shallow end. So there's a lot of things you can do in the deep end of the pool where you're not getting that same impact. Everything we do, every action causes a reaction. So on land, you're getting that reaction constantly back from the land, the surface, whatever surface you're working on. In the pool, you can do so much more without creating other painful joints to flare. So if a person, for instance, comes in with osteoarthritis in their knee or their hip, you know, as you're trying to rehab that knee, you can very easily flare up the hip if you do, you know, too much on land-based therapy. So
and what are the results? So you're saying, for you know, for example, if somebody does have knee issues and they're in pain and they come to you for the water treatments, what type of results can they expect to see? And obviously different people, different courses of time, different treatments, but how much can they get back?
They can get a lot of, we can't go back and change what's happened to the cartilage. Having said that, there's a lot of ways of strengthening a joint. around an osteoarthritic joint that can prolong surgery, prolong like cortisone injections and things like that. So the best thing we feel to do is try to eliminate, you know, a lot of pain medications that they may be taking, or a lot of injections that they may be taking, because that again is a foreign substance in our body. So if we can strengthen that joint, if we can do some basic modalities to calm it down, calm the swelling down, get to the source of the problem, then that person can more than likely avoid any other type of surgery or injection.
So just so I'm clear, so you're basically building up, you're giving that particular area a support system around it.
Correct.
So that it stabilizes where the problem area
is. Good word, stabilizes. That is a very important thing, because once the cartilage has changed, now you've got a bone that's very close to another bone. I had a patient one time refer to bone on bone as trying to walk across a pavement on your knuckles. I never forgot that, because that bone-on-bone pain is what usually puts people on the operating table. And they may eventually still have to have a surgery, but the better you can get a person from a strengthening standpoint and a stability standpoint pre-surgery, the better results are going to get if they have to have surgery.
Right. So prevention is as much as you can in whatever form.
Absolutely.
So our viewers, again, if they have some issues, what's the best way for them to get started with you?
We feel that the sooner the better. You know, the sooner you can come in and start getting the things that we've just discussed, the better, and maybe even prolong having to have that surgery if possible. It just depends on the situation. But the best way to get started with us is to, you can come in without a doctor's order for an evaluation, or you can go to your doctor, get an order, come in for the water-based therapy, come in for all of the other therapies that we do for those conditions, and we do an evaluation, set up a plan of care, and get people started right away.
Okay. So, and again, you when they come in, you'll evaluate whether they need to a short term, longer term. It's person to person.
Absolutely. And oftentimes we get a lot of information from their physician as to whether or not they want what's called pre-surgery physical therapy, or, you know, are we in a situation where we're not ready for surgery yet, and we're going to do everything possible to try to prolong that? So it just depends, again, on the stage that they're in, how many other joints they may have that are, you know, arthritic at that time, and you know, it takes a lot on their part too. We can't just do it by ourselves, so the patient has to be willing to do some things as well.
And this is just a, you know, a question, because I've you know, I have a couple of friends that take glucosamine. I mean, are there natural remedies such as that that can also help internally?
Absolutely, there are. You know, there's a lot of studies out there about glucosamine, and depending on, you know, which one you read, you can you get some that think it's the end all be all, and then others that not so much. So, you know, anything natural that we can do, anything that we can do that is what we like to refer to as regenerative rehab, where we can regenerate what's going on there with the structures that are needed, the better.
Okay.
Staying away from those foreign substances.
Absolutely. Great. Well, thank you again for being here.
Thank you
Always
so
a pleasure.
Yes. Thank you. Looking forward to next time.
Okay.
Great.
Me too.